A warm welcome to all those who've connected on Zoom for this knowledge sharing session organized by Zena International Foundation, XIF for short. Those who may not be aware, Zena Group has a number of entities of which XIF is one of them. And this is brainchild of Mr. Rajiv Anand. Let me start by playing a short video which illustrates the vision.
In a world vision document, we're a family bringing joy, happiness, prosperity in our lives and around by nurturing, encouraging, catalyzing, enabling 360-degree well-being in physical, intellectual, emotional, social, and economic dimensions. Our vision, abundance of joy, happiness, care, and prosperity for all. We strive for alleviating pain, suffering and poverty, encouraging unshackled-free thoughts, enabling dignified jobs and livelihood, nurturing close family bonding, seeking joy and happiness in the impact caused. Our values, passion, work with passion and from heart. Humility, learning attitude, mutual respect, and open to listening to others. Our values, integrity, sincere, honest, and ethical principles. Our values, empathy. Understand and feel others as your own. Our values, humanity, have compassion, brotherhood, fellow feeling, and kindness. Our values, joy, work that brings joy and value, diversity and inclusion. Character, trust, belief, faith, and confidence in self and in others, from where love and compassion emanate. Our character, virtue, high moral values, patience, consideration, trustworthiness, and forgiveness. Character, transparency, honesty, openness, and not guarded. Thank you.
Dr. Subham Bhattacharya is a PhD in computer science in 2005 for the work on speech synthesis and speech recognition, with 5 granted patents and 47 research papers published. He developed speech synthesizer for Odia and Bangla. He holds a master's in electronics and telecommunications in 1997. He has over 24 years of experience in TCS, the director of School of Career Advisory and head Next Gen Learning at KIIT University, the director and chief executive at Catalyst, spelled as K-A-T-A-L-L-Y-S-T, an AI-driven learning aggregator for people, chief architect of academic and career transformations. He teaches subjects like software engineering and national head open learning at TCS Ion. In short, he has an enviable combination of being an educationist and an entrepreneur.
So good evening, all of you. It's a fantastic Zena family. Every week I see a lot of good knowledge sharing session happening. So I also given consent for a topic which is pretty relevant as far as today's technology transformation is concerned. So this is AI journey from L to E. So this particularly why I have chosen this L to E is basically from lab to enterprise. You have seen, like Atul sir already spoken about me, like I'm the guy who actually started my making my hands dirty in as far as AI is concerned. Means if you talk about AI, long back in I encountered AI in 2000, rather you can say. In 2000, I was interested to do some research work. So when I completed my master's, then I was briefly a teacher for some engineering college for some time. Then I thought of doing some research and doing something different. Then I, of course, I have been asked to go to IIT Kanpur and stayed for 6 months there. And at that time, IIT Kanpur was the only place where the language processing research was going on. Mainly, you can talk about OCR, optical character recognition, or speech synthesis, or speech recognition. So those are very pretty nascent, like pretty, you can say, just research started. And because I had a combination of electronics, like digital world, digital signal processing and all, and computer science was my interest areas. In 2000, I was being introduced to some good programming language as well. So I thought of doing something different altogether, not like a typical theoretical research, rather I should do some differentiator in this. So I went to IIT Kanpur for doing some language processing research. So in that language processing research, I can remember, so looking into my profile, at the time, Professor R.M.K. Sinha was there, who was heading the entire project of Government of India. He told, why not you, this is a new thing, speech processing, nobody has started yet. So we have started something on Hindi language. So why don't you start working for Eastern India few language, where you are a Bengali guy and you can always do Bengali. And as because you are from Odisha, so you can take another language to Odia. So I took these two languages as my challenging task. You know, nothing has been done, let me tell you. Nothing has been done by that time. Can you please mute? So the lab concept, see, the lab concept, why I've given this name lab, because at the time, what today you see, Amazon or Google talk sort of thing. So actually at the time also, even in English, they are not pretty successful as far as the language processing is concerned. So then my journey started. So I started, and it took around 4 to 5 years to actually come up with some solution. And I handed it over to CDAC. CDAC was my funding agency at that time. So I handed over the entire source code and everything to CDAC. And fortunately, I am very lucky that the software that I've developed at that point of time was text-to-speech sort of software in both Oriya and Bangla. And it is widely being used during that time for the blind people to read the newspapers and all, right? Because the scanned newspapers are being given in the system, and the machine automatically can start speaking in that particular language, either Hindi, Odia or Bengali. So that was a journey, and in doing that, I published papers and I did patents and all this thing. And fortunately, when I see all this development today as a business model, I can see that actually what AI I thought during that time is now is a business model. So L2E, basically, that's why I have chosen lab to enterprise. There is a whole concept behind this. So I'll discuss about how the business scenario is changing today, because a lot of use cases also I'm doing, working with some of my students as well. So now next, go to the next slide, is called the journey. You see, this is how AI is not new. Like, people might be thinking AI is new, but AI almost started in 40s, you can see. Then in 2000, we are in 20, you can see a lot of changes has happened in during this time. You can see, if you can look at initial days, like neural network, people used to call, then training, then a lot of other algorithm like generative algorithm, etc., weblet transforms, okay? Now, if you can, the maturity has come when IBM started working on the Watson, used in a combination of machine learning and natural language processing to beat humans on Jeopardy. Right? So by 2011, you can see, because IBM always become the number one company in the world to bring such kind of innovations and all. So they are the people who brought in the Watson into the market as a research into actual application part of it. So that is what the journey started. So it's a combination of, you can say, machine learning as an algorithm and the natural language processing. What I'm talking about is like creating your dictionary or thesaurus or or OCR or speech to text or text to speech all combined together, some model has come out as a from lab to enterprise model, you can say. Next comes 2014, you can see Facebook developed a deep face, you know, a deep learning facial recognition system. That is, you might be seeing now Facebook is quite matured in this. The moment you tag a photograph, automatically it identifies this guy, you can tag this guy. Okay, because the database is pretty now, it is matured enough to handle all this. Then 2016, you can see Google's kind of thing. Then 2020, machine learning is almost in every sector, I'm telling you. Even healthcare, you talk about travel and hospitality, you talk about retail, you talk about manufacturing, IT service, of course, it is there. So all these are already there in practice to talk about today's AI, this thing, penetration. Now you can see how the timeline has distributed, like whatever I've shown in that, like 40s or 50s, like AI is any techniques which enables computers to mimic human behavior. So people thought like that, it's a game or sort of thing. So it is not matured as a business model. Now when machine learning came into picture, you can see the AI techniques is more mature, that gives computers the ability to learn without being explicit programmed to do so, right? So the learning basically starts because when I talk about image recognition, right? Talk about image processing, or I can say forecasting, right? In that case, what exactly happened is that a data set is already ready. I have an algorithm and it can give a proper forecast to me, or it can recognize properly. So the training algorithms have very, very matured, has come up. And now machine learning is very, very mature. You can see in 2000, 2010, almost they are ready to work for enterprise. Now when the deep learning came into picture, like 2020s, we talk about a subset of machine learning, which makes the computations of multi-layer neural network visible. So that is what the you can say the big time participant can now see. Somebody is writing something. And my PPT is visible to all of you, right? Yes?
Yes.
Okay, fine. Okay. So this is how the journey of AI, you can say, as I told you, why I chosen this particular topic L2E, because it's my topic, because I have done lab. I have implemented into a prototype sort of thing, which has been used in some specific group of people. Then today, if you look at AI and ML has gone into almost every sector of the business. So that is what today's session, like introduction, then how AI is different and applications, what we do have, advantages, disadvantages, growth and future of AI, and conclusion. We can see that. So next is, what is AI? So AI is artificial intelligence, is the simulation of human intelligence processed by machine, especially computer system. See, what exactly human intelligence is all about? Like we can think, we can replicate, we can analyze, right? So can a machine do this? That is what thought of, because machine is zeros and ones, right? So it's the algorithm which actually works. So the human who created the algorithm make the machine smarter, the processing speed has gone up. So this combination of algorithm versus your speed of machine or processing power of machine has increased. So now AI is actually what we dreamt is now the proper application today. And AI has made it possible to deposit checks from, so these are few of the use cases, you can say, from the comfort of your home. AI is a proficient to deciphering handwriting, making online checks, processing. Then the way of fraud can be detected on by observing the user's credit and spending patterns, etc. So one beautiful example I want to quote here, how AI and data science club together, you can say. Now, today, if you look at, see, earlier 10 years back, we might have a huge amount of data. You know, data collection is not new. It is huge. I mean, almost 20 years back, if you look at the IT systems, we used to have a lot of data running around, right? Maybe in the legacy system or sort of thing like that. You talk about a banking system, talk about retail, you talk about any place, a lot of data used to come, right? So in this case, like, let me give one example of the retail, which I have done one case study on this and created, of course, I wanted to file a patent, but it was already filed long back, so I could not able to file it. See, today, if you look at retail industry, if you talk about apparel industry, okay, if you talk about e-commerce in the apparel sector, the dress sector, right? So if you go to Myntra.com today, so what do you see? Myntra 5 years back and you see Myntra today, there's a lot of differences are there, right? So you go, your selection criteria has a lot of things are there. You talk about price criteria, you talk about color criteria, you talk about brand criteria, you talk about texture criteria, you talk about like anything you talk about, like the criteria you can define onto this. And then the selection comes to you, right? And then you choose your apparel, like you choose your top or t-shirt, right? Then the my patent was that, of course, I could not able to file it, but my thought process was that, can I create a digital mannequin, right? Like a virtual mannequin, you can say, in which I should give my all features, like what is my soldier, what size, what is my texture, what is my complexion, right? And then what is my body weight, etc. What is my height, etc. Then I asked the mannequin, I'll create a mannequin in front of me, of a replica of someone in front of myself, right? So then I'll start choosing the t-shirt, right? I'll start colors or maybe the size, whatever. Then the moment I see that this suits me perfectly fine, then I go and procure it or buy it. So if I can successfully do this, then my return policy and other things will be drastically dropped down, right? Because today what is happening, even if I'm buying, once it's being delivered, I see the things are not as per my requirement is concerned or my size or something like that. But if I created a virtual mannequin, it can be done. So what exactly I tried to do in that particular ideation is that because many e-commerce companies are struggling for this return policy, you know, a lot of in the supply chain itself, a lot of disturbance happening or store keeping in the warehouse and all this distribution channel is happening. So I thought if we can create something like that, like we go to a shop and go and do a trial room. So that is almost like a virtual trial room. So the example I want to give it here, why it is very, very important. So once I buy something, even if I do not know, someone somewhere is capturing my data. The system is capturing my data. What exactly I'm choosing, which location I am, for whom I am buying, what is my price range, which particular time of the year I am buying, right? So these are the different parameters. Even if I do not know, I just simply traveling in a bus and I keep on browsing and buying and all this thing, but system is capturing all the data. Now these data, even if we call it is a huge data or a big data, whatever you can say, but this data actually gives me proper business application, right? Now, today's world and 15 years back world, the difference is that 15 years back, we did not have sufficient storage, okay? And sufficient algorithms are not there to filter the data, which is relevant, which is not relevant. But today, if you look at almost every data, whatever transaction I'm doing, there is a place to store because huge data stores available. And processing speed has increased and the filtration, data filtration algorithms are working pretty fantastically fine. So that means, suppose I have my birthday maybe next month at a particular day, and last year the similar time I did the purchase. And the system knows that this is my birthday, right? So then from 15 days back or 20 days back, I'll start getting the alert, right? Your birthday is coming on this date. Why don't you try this? Because you tried this one. This has come new into the market. This is so all this, and you will get a discount of 20-30% if you lock it now, et cetera, et cetera. So that is what the business is today. So my point of saying here, AI is nothing that is away from or different from or a rocket science sort of thing, but it is something, it is the algorithm which works and give a proper business value. And this particular example, if you can replicate, even in the travel and hospitality sector, even to the medical science today, like do I need to go to a doctor unless I am in an emergency? Because authentic data with a proper filtration is available today. I simply go write my symptoms, and the paid sites, which are authentic sites, will tell me, these are the symptoms you do have, and these are the home remedy you do have. You need not to visit a doctor immediately. And if this parameter goes beyond this, then immediately consult a doctor. Or else, in many medicine stores, or the medicine companies, what they are giving today, like pharmaceutical companies today, what they're giving, they have their own doctors as well. If I do not have a doctor, they connect me to a doctor with a proper time, this thing slot, and both patient and the doctor discuss, and then prescription is generated and the medicine reaches your home. See how fantastically the data or filtered data or the proper data is being captured, stored, a right kind of algorithm being used, and the proper business applications are coming. So AI has made it possible to do all this, you know. So if similar to that, if you talk about this fraud detection sort of thing, like credit card fraud or your banking sector fraud, so the detection AI does pretty, pretty fantastically than manual way of thing, because system understand the fraud very minutely. Some digit either or there, or you try so password more than 3 times, or you did some kind of wrong transaction. So a system captures all the data and alert you. Your credit card is being wrongly used and all. But earlier, if you talk about 10 years back, all fraud is being done, then you come to know, right? So that is what the power of AI is all about. Now, the basic objective of AI is to enable computers to perform such intellectual tasks as decision-making, problem-solving, perception. So these are the human intelligence does. So machine can also are also doing understanding human communication. Like some students are doing some projects on gesture movement, right? Or body language analysis. So the image processing in Python, the library, it's so powerful today that they can see that what exactly the body language, whether it's in irritated mood or in a happy mood, in a romantic mood or a sad mood, the system automatically detects and give you a proper solution for this. So that is how the system and AI and image processing or mood analysis or mood processing, so everything club together and can be given as an app to the users, basically. Next is, So now how AI is different. So it's, AI is non-creative. Of course, it's not a human brain. So we cannot expect creativity as of its own unless and until it creates something on this, then precise and consistent and multitasking. So these are the AI characteristics you can talk about. The natural intelligence is creative, may have error because as I told in the fraud detection case, you might have error also, human related errors. Non-consistent because human brain changes from one point to the other point of time. I cannot handle more than one task in majority of the cases. So that is what, so AI takes care of all these things. Now applications, as I told few example, like telecommunications, yes, AI in telecom industry include handling large volumes of data using machine learning and analytics, automating detection, correction of failures in transmission, where failure has happened in electrical transmission line, how to, like IoT, Atul sir was talking about, like IoT is nothing but full of sensors. And today, why it is possible? Because of IPv6, right? So a lot of data from sensors in many fraction of seconds have been collected. Now, if I cannot analyze the data, if I do not process the data, how can I get the business out of it? So if you talk about traffic management, talk about vehicular movement, you talk about garbage management, you talk about transportation system. So everywhere you can say this data come AI, come IoT as a data collection agent. So all these things can be thought of, brought into, and technology can really bring a change out of it. Then in the robotics part, you can say the robots, the phenomenal, like they have replaced human like anything in hotel restaurants. They are working as your waiters, right? In today's virtual classes, you know, robots can be fed and they can act like a teacher in the schools and all. So robots are replacing human requirement where there is a repetitive works are there. So robots are actually working fantastically in those locations. And robotics process automation, RPA is a fantastic budding tool. You can say in almost all sector of engineering, you know, starting from manufacturing or civil or whatever. And I always suggest students to at least gain L1 or L2 competency level on RPA, because whenever they join in any organizations, they are no more into a manual kind of labor today. So it's highly automated organizations and they need to understand the robotics as a process model, right? Then in the banking sector, you see today hardly you go to banks. So everything on app, on a single click or on a single app, you are transferring money or deposit money or paying the loans or managing the entire fund, your stock market, except everything is being done in the app. So things are now pretty simpler as far as the AI is concerned. And some other applications like marketing, as I told, chatbots. Yeah, of course, chatbots are, you might have seen any CRM application like you can say the airlines, you know, or hospital. You can see a lot of chatbots are coming for assistance. So you fed all the FAQs, you fed all the AI enabled FAQs, you know, which question can be asked after this. So these are all trained FAQs. So can we make chatbots on this? Then transport, as I told, camera to catch older people not following the safety rules and all, these are all IoT sensor, etc., can be brought in here. satellite controls than school college today, because myself has transformed the education using AI AI platform, you know, and the results are fantastic, let me tell you. So the experience that I do have last 2.5-3 years of AI platform, how it can transform the learning. And fortunately, this pandemic made almost everything is virtual or digital. And a digital means I can control. So whether students is attending or not, how much time is attending. If it is a digital platform learning, then is he actually going to the sites and learn or not? How much time he's spending? Is he completing the assignments on time? Is he submitting? Or how much time he's spending on the chat, on the group chat, et cetera, et cetera. Whether my moderator are actually or mentors are actually involved in this or not. So each and everything as a director or a head of the school, I can always monitor and see things are happening or not. And the results, because when you are being controlled, automatically the outcome is fantastic. You know, the results are also pretty good. And the astronomy and other things also, a lot of applications will have. Now, these are the advantages like of AI, and disadvantages like new and improved interfaces, the conversion of information into knowledge, then relieves information overload, available 24/7, helps in tracking faster decision, etc. A disadvantage is, of course, cost is increased because all are new applications being incorporated. So once the usage are more and mass production happen, cost will come down. Then few experienced programmers are available. Of course, now almost every student are being asked to groom themselves in the programming side of the AI or machine learning, like Python as a tool or a Java kind of concepts. And difficulty in software, of course, many people do not know what software to be used for which particular purpose. So that is what understanding or sensitization is required, right? Then available only when user is occupied and at work. So that is how disadvantage part of this AI is all about. Now, this is the growth. Man has long feared rise of the machine. So the growth is phenomenal, as I told, in almost every sector. So his own creation becoming smarter and more intelligent than he. So that is happening. But while AI and machine learning are rapidly changing our world and powering the fourth industrial revolution, like we called Industry 4.0, so humanity does not need to be afraid of this, because our creativity goes on increasing also as well. As a human, on the service front also, I'll start thinking, how can I apply those technology to my own service area? So new job creations are happening. You can say it's growing in the mode of creating new jobs. Some jobs are almost obsolete, you know, the bridging the language divides. So today, I did, by one of my patent is that, like, if I speak in Bangla here and the other recipient is a Telugu guy, so then even if I speak in Bangla, the recipient will get the translated in the Telugu itself. So that is also happening today. Then transforming the government, like blockchain kind of applications we are doing, delivering healthcare, creating art, etc. So everything is possible today, and the growth is definitely there. And these are all, like, digital revolution has already changed the life of people, war, communications, robotics are replacing our teachers as well as the people. AI is growing and having a great future ahead, and the man's amazing creations ever happened. Then everything on earth is for the cause of this thing. And AI has even replaced our calculators, our diaries, our notepads, our watch, whatever you can say. Nothing is actually important today, right? So AI has done everything. But whatever you want, you can get it on just in a single click, maybe from a device. So this is the conclusion part. So it is almost five. The goal of scientists working on AI is for solving the problem of the people. Like, that is what, like, as I started saying, that I have chosen a problem of making the how can a blind or a illiterate can read a newspaper, those who do not know how to read, right? So that problem I took for a common man, I was successful. So like that, the AI should be used for this kind of helping the common man problems, right? Because any pandemic, healthcare today, healthcare industry, I was just checking, almost 90% of the research is now on COVID, right? How to get the best in class information and get rid of this particular thing. So you should look into the positive sides, though there are a lot of negative sides also we do have encounter. And then AI is at the center of a new enterprise to build computational models for intelligence. The main assumption is that intelligence can be represented in terms of symbol structures, symbolic operations, which can be programmed in a digital computer. So everything can be programmed and easy also. So this is what I thought of you, like, today, and question answers, of course, I'll take up.
What are the areas of AI which are a cause of concern? Largely on businesses, you have very, very well amplified the applications and how it is helping both consumers and businesses. What are the areas in AI you think, at least, that are a cause of concern? We don't know much about it, or maybe it will develop into something which could be very either positive or not so positive. And so there's the first part of the question. And second is, if you would like to throw some light on how defense is using some of the AI applications or developing some AI applications from a very end user perspective.
Right. So first point is, the question is the disadvantage part that you talk about, right? See, what AI is nothing but a machine who is going to do prediction and all, right? Now, and as I told, it all depends on kind of data I'm feeding into the system, right? So what normally happens, the data, the quality of data or unfiltered data then can lead to disasters, you know. If say you just compare between two different vaccines, Covishield and Covaxin, and proper data are not being fed into by the proper authority. If the data I collect from the open source, like whoever posts anything on the Facebook or any other digital medium, etc., I take the data and without filtering it, I put it in the algorithm and it gives a very unprofessional results, you can say, that this causes this is happening this. So ultimately, when you know the reality by the proper authority, the cause of death is different, but it shows that it is due to the vaccine or something like that, right? So that is the case happening in any sector you talk about. If I do not have sufficient data or filtered data or tested data, I can say the data has to be tested, authenticity of the data, then it will take you to a disaster result, you know, then you are gone. But if it is being controlled, the data is being controlled, the data is properly used, then the best in class business use cases can be developed. And I am pretty sure that it is going to be only for benefits. I don't see any wrong side or the deficit side of this, but rather I can see AI and ML can have a proper applications which are beneficial for the end user or people like this, right? And second question is your defense. Definitely yes, because today if you talk about, as I told, IoT, as Atul sir was pointed out, see, now is all sensors, you know. Defense also highly sensor based, you know. You talk about camera, you talk about different type of signals capturing and all. Now, whether I'm putting the sensor in the right position or not, or the right data is being captured there from there or not. Suppose I talk about some meteorological sort of thing, like weather forecasting or Navy using the weather forecasting system, right? And if I do not have a proper mechanism to actually study the data which talks about the weather forecast for a particular region on inside the ocean and all, then if something wrong happens, then actually gone, right? So in that case also, in the defense case, or you talk about, if you talk about attacking some place and you said you send pilotless devices, drone or any other things to capture the data, and the data will feed back to your system and do analysis, and then you start doing the attack for this. So in that case, as I am right always saying, that proper data which is being captured at that point of time should be the authentic one. And according to that, algorithms today are pretty matured. And if you really feed the proper data, the results or the outcome will be fantastic. And we can do a very pinpointed application of this even in the military or defense sector. So this is what my say on this, Manish.
So in your experience, I mean, this brings to this point of data accuracy. Mm-hmm. And this is a question from Amitav Pathak. Mm-hmm. In your experience, have there been situations or where the data that has been received is either faulty, or even if it has not been faulty, has it been misinterpreted?
Absolutely. See, look at, if you, Manish, one thing just I want to highlight here. If you look at two data set, last year when COVID started, private agencies also given the data, state-wise data or affected data or district-wise data, etc., etc. And government used to give a data, right? So at that point of time, nobody knew which one to trust, right? And if the data is not correct, even if the government wants to do some kind of remedy or some kind of measures to supply some drugs or vaccination or some COVID center, etc., then if suppose some place it says 500, but actually it is 25 or 50. Is it clear? It's wastage of money and wastage of resources. So that is why I always say, when you feed the data for a particular application to be successful, it should be very, very authentic data, and proper testing should be done, and filtration has to be done. So before feeding the data into my system, filtration is a very, very huge task for any data science or AI applications today, right? So that is what somebody has to take the responsibility, and hopefully the government agency should take the responsibility of the respective department, and they should share the data instead of giving open source data. And open source data can lead to any disaster as well, right? That is what my take on this.
Sure. So this is the last question to you, sir. One of the points that is being raised is, are these algorithms that are being developed for AI, are these getting patented, or how is the knowledge generation in this process being regulated or made available to the public?
Yeah, for your understanding, let me tell you, in computer science, algorithms simply cannot be patented. Algorithm has to be made a system. So I have to create a system out of using the algorithm. That system can be patented as a prototype or a product sort of, right? Algorithm itself cannot be patented. Now, algorithms are mathematical models. So they might have copyright. See, I can publish a paper, and paper can be copyrighted on my name. But unless and until I make a system out of it, I cannot get a patent out of it, right? So that is one aspect of your question. Can I get the second part of this?
So the question, next part is more about, how is this knowledge shared across, if it is not patented, at least the algorithm, if it is not patented, then how?
As I told, even if it's a copyright paper, if you go to any site, you just Google Scholars, if you can type down, like your problem statement or something like that, they give a lot of papers. Some are paid, downloaded papers, some are free papers and all. You can refer to those papers and you can see that similar kind of use cases where it being used, and use those algorithms for your own problem as well. So you can do that. Atul sir, can you please elaborate the question so that I can briefly take it on?
Yeah, Suman, I just read about this, that the NASA claims that Sanskrit, mm-hmm, is the most suitable language to develop computer programming for the AI program. Mm-hmm. The grammar of Sanskrit is rule-bound, formula-bound, and logical, make it highly appropriate to write algorithms. Right. Now, is it curious to know, how is it so? Because, and why is it that NASA did the research and not somewhere in India? We got Sanskrit pundits here, and we got the best IT people also.
No, so, I did. Because as Atul sir, as I did my research on speech, yeah. So I spent around 6 months in Sanskrit University to understand how the pronunciation of vowels and consonants happen actually, right? Yeah. Because Veda itself, Veda chanting is the most powerful or authentic way of expression, you can say, like vocal expression, you can say. Now in that study, what I found, a single vowel, say A, can be pronounced in 72 different types. And A is nothing but just a duration elongation of A. It's a derived vowel. It's not a O and A we do have, but O, A is a derived part of this. Okay. So like that, O, E, and another vowel, just I forgetting, those are the three fundamental vowels, and rest all are derived vowels out of this. And each one I have derived from a Sanskrit professional chanting guy. I recorded those things. I did the analysis for that as well. Right. And looking into the, as you rightly asked the question, like the very scientific grammar, because if you go to Panini, as the core grammar of Sanskrit, if you go and Google search, the owner of Sanskrit grammar, who actually did a lot of research on this, is a Panini. Okay. Now in that Panini, if you see, even if any word, you say any word that we utter, either tatsama, tadbhava, or desaja. Tatsama means same as Sanskrit, tadbhava means derived from Sanskrit, or desaja means very colloquial. For a particular local language, they use it. They are not read from any place, right? Now, tatsama, like in that, almost 80% of the Indian languages you can talk about are being derived from the tatsama words. And base word, the root word, when I talk about a word processing or a creating a thesaurus or a dictionary for Indian language, then Sanskrit is the base one. From that, the derivation happens, right? So that is what the root. So definitely, even the French people, I think some researchers I met during my stay there, so they also came because they claim that their language is derived from Sanskrit. So that means it's not only Indian languages, but many other languages are being derived from Sanskrit. So they might have studied something on that, and I think that is the best way to represent.
I think we'll carry this conversation offline.
Intriguing. Sure. Very interesting.
And sorry for the shortage of time. I'll have to now move on to the next speaker. Thank you very much, Suman.
Thank you.
It's a very enlightening kind of presentation, and to know more about AI.
And for everyone's missing, my daughter, as she has designed this poster, and because I did not have time in the morning, she made the PPT entirely. She studied the entire thing, then she made the PPT and told me you have to present from this.
Her name is Shana.
Shana, she is in standard 7 now. So she has done this.
So please convey our thanks from all of us.
Thank you,
to Shana.
Thank you.
She is really doing well, and we hope to see more stuff coming out of her. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you
so much.